for Tabor Johnson. We'll open with second row right there, Dave.
Welcome back, Tabor. Dave Biddle from 24 Sports and Bucknuts. Good to see you again.
Good to see you.
Is this something you thought might happen? Was this kind of in your mind you might come back to Ohio State, or when Urban contacted you, was it kind of a surprise? Can you kind of just take us through the process?
Crazy process, you know, when things happen, you kind of, you go through that, you know, hope stage, you know, and having some familiarity with guys on the staff, especially head coach, and then you have to go attack. You know, you have to go out and do everything you can to try to, you know, make it happen and get yourself in a better position. And when Coach gave me a call, again, I was surprised, you know, because all you may do and all the help that you get, you never know until the end. And it happened, and I couldn't be more excited.
Take us back to when Coach Meyer was hired. Had you already left for Arkansas for that 2011 season? Did he ask you to stay on staff? Just, I guess, why did you leave for Arkansas?
Right, not yet. I was still here. That's always the number one question. You know, what made you leave? At that time, it just felt like, I felt at the time I needed to venture out, you know, and Alex kind of hit on it, kind of in the profession. When you go through different stages, trying to get a different stage at that time, in that point in my career. That's what I felt. Again, was it right, was it wrong? It was a great learning experience. I wouldn't take it away for anything in the world, even though, you know, we had some bumps and bruises, you know, but that's what allowed me to continue on my career and actually get back here at this point in time. So very thankful for that, really am.
All right, Austin.
Austin Moore with AM10. Tabor, this might sound silly to someone who's already accomplished what you have, even at this place, but this run with first-round draft picks at the cornerback position, what Kerry Combs did when he came in to replace you, is there anything that's intimidating or pressure-packed about keeping that going, given the run of success it's had since you left?
Intimidating, no. Pressure, always. You know, Kerry's done a great job, and those guys, the whole staff, have done an outstanding job, you know, not just producing those first-rounders, but just, you know, quality young men that have come through these doors. I told the guys, and I already know I have some big shoes to fill, and I'm accepting that challenge, and I'm excited about it. You know, that's the one thing about Ohio State, Coach Meyer, for sure, that not just talent-based people that come into the program, but just really, really great people. And he attracts those kind of people from the staff as well as players. So I'm just thankful to be here to do that.
And it seems like you're inheriting quite a lot of talent there at that position. How will you manage that in the spring? Want to continue this rotation that they've used over the last couple of years? What are your kind of plans early? I know spring ball doesn't start till Tuesday, but what do you envision there at that spot?
Well, and that's what we still have to talk about as a staff, you know, because we just want to make sure that we're able, and everything we do will be evaluated, you know, whether it's, you know, not just team reps or one-on-one reps, but everything our guys do will be evaluated and will be coached, more importantly, to get them better. Rotation-wise, again, that's what we're, you know, having our meetings about. We'll have a plan, just not sure, not concrete on the plan yet, is developing, and it'll be finishing very shortly.
Third row left, Dan.
Tabor, when you left the first time and, you know, maybe passed up an opportunity to work for Urban the first time around, were you a little bit surprised that he would come back to you and want you to come back to his staff this time around?
Kind of yes and no, you know, because Coach Meyer and I have known each other for over 20 years. He knew that it was not personal whatsoever. And when I left, it wasn't on bad terms whatsoever. But again, when you tell Coach Meyer no, that's always a tough thing, you know, because I know what type of person he is, as well as Coach. So that was tough. But then also, I think just going back and having the friendship and everything that he understands that I believe in and we believe in the same things, when the opportunity came about, you know, I was thankful for that.
In your first few weeks here, what are the biggest ways in which you've seen this program change from when you were here previously and where it is right now?
I think Alex hit on it. You know, it's just when you walk in the door every day, you know, you're going 100 miles an hour. You know, we were able to do some really good things, you know, when I was here the first time with Coach Russell, which I'm thankful for, again, that allowed me also probably to come back. But just the ongoing of everything that we do at such a high rate, high expectation, every day constantly it's good. It challenges you as a person. It challenges you as a coach. And that this really, really within this last, whatever, 8-9 days I've been working has already made me better overall.
Second row right, Tony.
Tony Gerdeman, the Ozone. Getting back to the rotation, this was something that Kerry Combs had been trying for years before he finally got it to work in 2016. And when he was a quarterback coach, were you aware of what Ohio State was doing, what they were able to do at all? Like when you were elsewhere, were you aware they were able to get these three talented corners in 2016 and then do it again last year?
No, I wasn't. I mean, I watched from afar. And the times, and there were times on tape that we, would play people that Ohio State played and had a chance to watch those gentlemen play, just going, oh my goodness, man, these guys are, man, loaded, you know, just didn't realize the depth of talent, you know, and when you have that, you know, that many guys and you're able to rotate, then you want to, there's no doubt about it, and seeing that happen, obviously it worked, and that's something that I feel like you said, with the talent that we have, that could be an opportunity here as well.
Front row right, Bill.
Bill Rabinowitz, Columbus Dispatch, welcome back.
Thanks.
When you left in 11, obviously a very difficult year. You watched Ohio State achieve some amazing things. Were there times during your absence where you thought, should I have left? Was there any second doubts in your mind, or second thoughts in your mind?
Oh, you go through that phase, not really, you know, because you try to tell the players don't have any regrets, you know, don't have any things that kind of, you know, get to you. More importantly, I was ecstatic, you know, because I know the kids, I knew everyone in administration. Like I said, Coach Meyer, I've always been a big fan of his. So again, I grew up in Cincinnati, I grew up a Buckeye, you know, so always rooted for him regardless, and to see all the success that's happened, I was really excited.
And could you give your little thumbnail analysis of the guys you have, particularly Damon Arnett and Kendall Sheffield and Jeff Yakuda, for example?
Right, very, very, again, talented guys, very smart individuals. That's what I'm learning about those guys. They have some football smarts to them. You can tell they're veterans. They're very serious about what they do. You know, they come to work, you know, and come and have fun. And you know, they don't treat it like a job, but they understand when it's time for us to get to work. They kind of help the younger guys do that as well. With Jeff Okuda really being a guy, you know, he's not doing a ton right now, but he's getting the young guys and really explaining and coaching them, you know, while I'm on the other side. So just embody all those guys that embrace each other every day, you know, and hold each other accountable. That's the other thing. I mean, that's something that goes beyond coaching, you know, when the players start holding each other accountable and not just getting on each other, but helping each other out, giving the reasons why. And then once we get to the point, they've already been there where they're echoing the same things. That's key. That's what I've noticed.
Second row left, Ari.
Ari Wasserman, The Athletic. Tabor, I know that the first part of your Ohio State career here, the first time around, was under Jim Tressel. And I'm just wondering, I know that you guys haven't had practice or anything, but how different does this place feel now than it did back in 2007, 2008?
Really different. You know, it feels brand new. Again, when I walked in the first time and just walking through the hallways, you know, a lot of things that have changed within the inside. Even just this room, you know, we didn't have the black seats and the Ohio State logo, this podium. But at the same time, I think I hit on it just in terms of, you know, even before I show up, you know, getting here, and not just the first day or because I'm new, but just understanding. And Alex said, you know, it's not the flip of the calendar for everyone on staff. Everyone has to be ready to go 100 miles an hour, detailed, all those things all the time. And that's what's new, that's what's different.
Jim always recruited at a very high level, top 10 classes, but Urban has taken it to another level in terms of recruiting results. Are the players better now? Not to slight the old ones, but is it a different level here talent-wise from top to bottom?
There is a different level. There's no doubt about it. I think we've gotten here recently. Coach Meyer and the staff have done a great job of getting more of the talent, you know, the times they've been here. I don't know if when Coach Tressel was here the first time, if he had the numbers of guys that were talented. We had some talented guys that developed. I think the guys that come here talented and then also get developed, and then that's why the place is going through the roof.
So. Having been exposed to do different types of recruiting strategies, Jim was more Ohio branch out, and I know Urban still is pretty big on Ohio, but he's been a more national approach. what do you think of the two differing recruiting strategies, and do you feel like part of the reason why Ohio State's taken it to the next level from a talent standpoint is because of the branching out from a national perspective?
I think not just the branching out, but I think Coach Meyer and staff have done a great job of just adjusting how you recruit today's athlete. Before, we were writing notes a lot, doing a lot of different things that way. Well, how many times have players open up mail? And Coach has done a great job, those guys have done a great job of evaluating what are the recruits really interested in, and really hitting those points with the recruits, with the parents, and adjusting to the times of the players. And I think they've hit it on the nail with a lot of them and a lot of the parents, and that also helped in terms of getting more talented guys here.
Second row middle, Ryan.
Sean Wade is a guy who is one of the more talented recruits in the 2017 class, but he redshirted last year because of injuries. I don't know how much you've met these guys yet, but do you have an indication of how healthy he is now, whether he's been doing workouts and whether he'll be good to go in spring?
Yeah, as far as I know, he's been doing everything, especially since I've been here. I'm really excited to see Sean get out there. He's been moving around and doing a great job thus far. So I'm excited to get to practice because now we can get to, doing a little more football. And you can really see, these guys. They want to compete. Sean's a competitor. But now everyone in the program is going to compete. Everyone's going to be a competitor. What's going to take some of the guys to the next level? And how are they going to do it? And again, that's what I'm excited about to see.
Third row middle, Taylor.
Taylor Ashbrook, EBSN. Just wondering, you've spent a lot of time around both Jim Tressel and Urban Meyer, both widely successful coaches, maybe in different ways, but just what are the differences in their personalities like behind closed doors? And if you could maybe just shed a little bit of light on that, just the differences between both successful coaches.
Right. Coach Tressel, again, I think you said in terms of a lot of people saw Coach Tressel as mild-mannered guy. But Coach was the ultimate competitor. Behind closed doors, he was intense, Coach Meyer, what you see is what you get. When it's time to get going and you see him during game day and all that, that's how he is for sure, behind closed doors when we're going through our staff meetings and talking about specific things. He's fiery, he's into it. He sits on the edge of his chair, thus the rest of us are sitting on the edge of our chairs, and not just to make 1 point or 2 points, but to make sure everybody's on the same page. So just those different personalities, really, in terms of Coach Meyer being fiery, Coach Tressel being mild-mannered, but both really, really unbelievable competitors.
And then obviously, you taking over for a guy like Kerry Combs, who's, we talked about how many first-round draft picks he's had in the last few years, but I mean, you've sent quite a few guys to the NFL yourself. I mean, one guy just won his second Super Bowl championship a couple weeks ago. Do you feel a little, maybe, have you felt like you've been maybe kind of an afterthought and not respected as much for the talent that you have produced as opposed to maybe a newer guy that hasn't quite made his name yet?
Not at all. Because, again, when it comes to the players and the success they have, that's what it's all about. As a coach, you really don't. The only thing you want to do is make sure, and what Malcolm is and a lot of guys are, now that they're older, that I coached the first time, they're great husbands, they're great fathers, they're doing great in the community. The success Malcolm has had, some of the other guys have had on the field, that's the work that they put into it. Being a coach, you're behind the scenes, you're pushing 1,000%. And Coach Combs and I've known Coach Combs for probably 15, almost 20 years when he was in high school. I would go down to Cobrain and sit with him and pick his brain. Tremendous coach. So, I never felt that way whatsoever because I don't want to be, and I don't think any of us really want to be, associated with, kind of pushing that guy or being able to get that guy, to the NFL. It happens. But as a coach, that's the last thing you think about. You want to develop that young man inside and out, between his ears, and then when the football takes over, you just want to make sure you enhance that.
We got time for a couple more questions. Front row right, Tim.
Tim Maycomb, special. Did y'all move into the same house you left?
Well, knock on wood. It's funny you said that. We're hoping, we finish on a house that's probably two blocks away from where we were last time. So we're excited about that. hopefully, like I said, we get that done, and that'll happen here in April. So I get the family out here, and you'll see me smiling a lot more. I get my daughter here, especially.
That same house, the same neighborhood.
Same neighborhood, yes, yes.
What do you touched on this a couple of times, but Urban Meyer, if you had to describe him, is it he challenges you every minute of every day? How would you describe it?
I think challenge is the first word that comes to it, but you know, I think it's one of those things where it's not just a challenge, it's the perfection. You know, it's the perfection. You know, and it's hard to be perfect, and everyone understands that. You guys may hear me say it in practice, you know, perfect practice makes perfect. You know, one of my coaches told me that. Well, probably not going to be perfect, but guess what? If you're practicing your tail off and really focused in and doing your job and doing it as hard as you possibly can, you can get pretty close to it. And I think that's part of it. You know, it's never demeaned. It's never – he has all of our best interests at heart. You know.
How has cornerback play, just in a nutshell, changed in the last 10 years from your – the teaching of it, not necessarily, because that'd be a thesis, but mm-hmm. What do you see that's demanded of corners more and more? Well, I mean, obviously these guys like to play press man, mm-hmm. you know, because it sets the stage for everything else, but what is it that you've seen really develop over the last 10 or 12 years at that specific area?
I think the finish at the ball, you know, the guys have done a great job when the ball's in the air, not panicking, you know, being able to not just knock it down, but make a play. That's the key as well. I think before you get into the route, there's some things that we can get better at, and we will. But the finish has been unbelievable. It really has. And that's what has allowed the defense to be very successful around here. And that we need to keep that component without a doubt.
Yeah, and you touched on something. It slipped by me, but you say Okuda's kind of watching right now. Did he have some kind of touch-up surgery or anything?
I'll let our medical staff handle that.
Okay. Okay.
But he is he's running around. He is running around doing some things for sure.
Okay. And final question, second row middle, Marcus.
Mark Sarver from Cox Media. He kind of stole my question about the style of play with the corners. But I wondered, I know obviously Coach Haycock, a lot of success under his style of defense. But I think what they're doing now, probably a lot different. Would you agree with that, and how would it have changed?
Yes, it is. It's definitely evolved. And we're doing some different things than what we did the first time I was here. And actually, again, that's why we're kind of going through some tapes, trying to figure out within the scheme that we have now, you know, how can we enhance that? So it's good. You know, Cosciano, he's done a great job the years he's been coaching, to have two head coaches and one NFL previous head coach on one staff. And he's produced numerous corners in the NFL. So get a chance to learn from him, you know, other styles and techniques and things like that. That's key. That's exactly what we're pinpointing right now.
And I wonder, if you're playing that maybe more of a man-to-man, some higher pressure type of a defense, does that kind of force your guys maybe to develop in a little different way if they're going to be out there on an island more?
The understanding more than anything, you know, the understanding that you're probably not going to have any help. We may not be blitzing, so a quarterback may hold that ball a little bit longer. So, again, that goes back to the perfection and, you know, the focus and all those things, the detail at the position for sure.
Coach, thank you very much.